Revolution, one of the Beatles' most game-changing songs of their career, with one of the most recognisable guitar sounds of the century. But what inspired lead singer John Lennon to write this timeless classic? Today, we'll look into the intricacies of the song and the musicianship and lyricism to find out exactly how John Lennon wrote Revolution. In 1968, tensions were high as the Vietnamese War was developing, and John Lennon was awakened by the growth of political protests and stated, "I thought it was about time that we spoke about it, the same way as I thought it was about time we stopped not answering questions about the Vietnamese War." The song is about revolution, how John wanted a change within the way of the situation was treated. The lyrics convey his feelings against violent protests. The assassination of Martin Luther King also had a part to play in the creation of this song, with its pacifist-driven approach to being struck down by violence. There are multiple versions of this song to break down in multiple different styles, so be warned, it's about to get complicated. The earliest known recording of the song is an acoustic demo recorded at George Harrison's home studio. A mix of takes 1 and 2 can be heard on the White Album 2018 remixes under the Isha Demo Collection. Say you want a revolution. This version is in the key of C and features hand claps from the remaining band members. Recording for the White Album began on the 30th of May, starting with Revolution. The earliest take that survives is take 18. This take runs for about 10 minutes and is in the key of A. John recorded his vocals for this track lying down on the floor, rather than standing up, maybe due to the relaxed nature of the song. Once the main verses had been sung during the song, the band continues to play the chords whilst John improvises by screaming "alright" over and over again, getting louder and louder. You may recognise those vocals from somewhere else, but we'll get back to that. Take 20 also survives, which is take 18, but with overdubs.
Alright, more
Revolution, RM1 of take...
Don't worry.
Take your knickers off and let's go.
As you said.
The song slowly develops into a sound collage of tape loops recorded by John Lennon and Yoko Ono, with strange otherworldly sounds. The sound of a radio tuning can be heard on this. This sample can also be heard on I Am The Walrus. This take can be split into two sections, the main song and the sound collage. The main song would later develop into the version heard on the album, entitled Revolution 1, and the sound collage would later become Revolution 9. Take 20 underwent some more edits, including electric guitar, a brass section, and a hurried announcement of take 2 from Jeff Emmerich, the sound engineer. Revolution 9 is one of the most well-known tracks on the album for its unorthodox approach. The Beatles had been experimenting with avant-garde music, but nothing quite like this. The song runs for about 8 minutes with constant tape loops, the most infamous being a sample taken from a test tape with an audio engineer saying, "number 9.
And the number 9, number 9, number 9 was an engineer's voice. You know, they have test tapes to see that the tapes are all right. Mm-hmm. And the voice was saying, "this is number 9 megacycles." So he was talking like that. And I just liked the way he said "number 9. So I just made a loop of him saying "number 9 and brought that in whenever I felt like it.
Number 9. Number 9, number 9, number 9.
This track was mainly made by John Lennon and Yoko Ono with input from George Harrison. Remember that vocal line from Revolution 1 I mentioned a minute ago? Well, that appears in this song at around 2 minutes and 40 seconds. John wanted Revolution to be put out as a single, but Paul McCartney disagreed because he thought it was too slow and was rather dubious about releasing such a political statement. But John was determined to have it as a single, so the band got to work on a more upbeat version. The more upbeat version is in the key of B and follows a 12-8 time signature. The song is very blues inspired and opens with a very similar riff to a much loved classic rock and roll opening. An unnumbered rehearsal exists, which is similar to the final album but is missing one integral part, the guitar tone. This take hears a completely clean guitar tone. John and George were most likely using Fender basement amps or Vox prototype amps at the time, but weren't happy with the sound that amps were giving them. Rather than using their guitar amps, they DI'd their guitars into the mixing desk with microphone preamps. The guitars were put through a dying overdriven channel, which creates the distorted and fuzzy sound on the record. One, two, three, four. the song was released, many returned the record due to them thinking it was broken. This song also features Paul McCartney playing his signature Hofner Cavern bass rather than him using his Rickenbacker 4001 after so many years. This bass has both of its pickups closer to the neck, which allows for a much more bassier and richer tone. Ringo plays drums as usual, but keeps the rhythm with just the toms, snare and the kick drum. No hi-hat is used throughout the song. In the lyrics, John sings, "When you talk about destruction, don't you know that you can count me out? In." The original lyrics stated, "Count me out." However, John later in performances said, "In," showing his conflicted opinions on the scenario.
But when you talk about destruction, don't you know that you can count me out?
That one word almost entirely contradicts the message of the whole song, and was therefore removed from the single release. However, in later live versions, John had included the extra lyric. Maybe this shows how his attitude changed over the time when the song was recorded.
But when you talk about destruction, don't you know that you can count me out?
There are many vocal splices throughout the track. This is where multiple vocal takes would be cut together, maybe due to some lines being sung better than others. These can be heard quite clearly on the isolated vocal tracks. Listen to the final verse, in which a cut can be heard where John Lennon sings the word head.
You say you'll change the constitution, well, you know, we all wanna change your head.
During the song, John is playing rhythm guitar in the right channel and George is playing lead on the left. However, after the first chorus, the tracks swap. Either this was some sort of production error or John and George simply alternate between verses. The lead guitar overdubs are mainly on John's track, although it is unclear who played these. The rhythm guitar is also absent for the solo. The song features an instrumental section which has a sporadic guitar solo and an electric piano overdub by Nicky Hopkins on the 11th of July. Meanwhile, John frantically moans over the top. This is somewhat retaining the messy nature of previous versions. The song was released as a B-side to Hey Jude on the 26th of August in the US and then released in the UK on the 30th, in which it peaked at number one. John later said he disliked the stereo mix made for the Blue Album, saying it was a heavy record in mono, but they turned it into ice cream. Two performance videos for the song were filmed at Twickenham Studios on the 4th of September, directed by Michael Lindsay Hogg. The two clips only had minor changes, for example, different shots or different lighting. The band mimed over a backing track, but sang vocals live. Instead, the lyrics sung were from Revolution 1 instead of the single version. The song was well received, despite an article by Chris Welch from Melody Maker who described the song as a fuzzy mess, best forgotten. The song had some worthwhile political effects, but the conflict was far from over. In summary, Revolution was ahead of its time, with its completely different styles bordering from grunge, shuffle and avant-garde. It has a truly inspiring backstory to it. Let me know what you guys think of Revolution in the comments, and let me know if you'd like to see me analyse any more songs like this. Thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you all next time. Goodbye.